This episode of Tales from the Crypt is sponsored by the Cash App. You freaks already know all about them. They're helping us stack sats. They've also been the number one finance app in the App Store for the last 2 years. They're the first peer-to-peer payments app to allow you freaks to buy Bitcoin. It's the easiest way in the U.S., in my opinion. No more having to wait 5 days for your ACH transfer to come through. With Cash App, you can buy Bitcoin instantly, and then when you're ready to take full ownership, when you are comfortable taking possession of your UTXOs and custodying your own private keys, just use the Cash App to scan an external wallet's QR code and send your Bitcoin off, where you can copy and paste the address into the Cash App and take custody of your own Bitcoin. Cash App also comes with standard banking features like direct deposits, other things that your bank doesn't offer, like the Boost program, the Cash Card, which is customizable and comes with the Boost program. You helps you instantly save anytime you use it at Lyft, Whole Foods, Chipotle, Chick-fil-A, Starbucks, Dunkin' Donuts, local coffee shops, which is my favorite. I used it 2 hours ago down the street and saved a dollar. Download the Cash App today from the App Store, Google Play Store, freaks, and keep stacking sats. Hope you enjoy this conversation with Ruben from Bittr. I know Matt and I had a really fun time talking with him. Okay. What is up, freaks? Welcome back to Tales from the Crypt. It's your boy Marty Bent here in the studio for recording number two of the day. Matt and I just ripped a rabbit hole recap that just went live, so I hope you freaks are liking that. We're sitting down with a very special guest who's come all the way from Portugal just to come on Tales from the Crypt. I'd like to introduce you freaks to the founder, CEO, and one-man team behind Bittr, Ruben Waterman. Ruben, welcome to the podcast.
Hey, thanks. Thanks for inviting me.
Thanks for coming, man. It seems like you had the most pleasant New York City customs.
Yeah, it was super fast. Just 20 minutes. Like, what's going on here? You guys actually want tourists?
Yeah. I've been a big hater on the customs in my last few international trips. It's been very hard for me, and I'm happy to hear that your experience was seamless, because it's a pretty terrible introduction to New York City is JFK customs.
I don't think I've ever heard one positive thing ever said about New York City.
Here's
customs.
The first.
There you go.
Ruben's with the first. We forgot the third mic before we recorded Rabbit Hole Recap. So Matt scooted back to his apartment to pick up that mic. And while we were there, I was diving into your tale. I think it's very interesting. So that's as we do on Tales from the Crypt. How'd you find Bitcoin? You seem to have a very very funny story.
Yeah, so while I was studying, I studied abroad for a while in Boston in the US. And one of my roommates was like, oh, you guys have to look into Bitcoin. And this was like kind of the crazy roommate. And I was like, oh, whatever. And he was like, yeah, that's what they use on Silk Road. You know, like this dark web. And I was like, not really intrigued by Bitcoin, but this dark web sounded interesting. So I got the Tor browser and figured out the onion address for Silk Road. And I just saw like all these weird things that, you know, were for sale, and everything was priced in Bitcoin. So I was like, that kind of scared me off. And I was like, oh, no Bitcoin for me.
And this was, you were studying in the States, was 2011?
Yeah, this was 2011, yeah.
So you have a very very common story where you find it on the Silk Road, and then a couple years later, it comes back to tap you on the shoulder and says, hey.
Yeah, so then in my last year of the bachelor back in Holland, one of the major Dutch banks asked a couple of students from my university, like, hey, can you send in like a couple of students every Friday for 3 or 4 months and study Bitcoin for us and see what we should do with it? And well, we were a team of six. All the other guys, they don't do anything with Bitcoin, but I stuck with it because I was like, oh, if this actually is going to work, it's amazing.
What sort of piqued your interest about it?
It being not inflatable, it's like my main, yeah, what got me into it is like the supply is fixed, it's 21 million and nobody can ever create more of it. Just like, I mean, this was while we were going through the 2008 financial crisis and just quantitative easing all over, and I was like, say goodbye to your savings.
So what was it like experiencing that crisis as a European? I mean, we have a lot of guests that come through and talk about the American point of view of the global financial crisis. What were you seeing over in Holland?
I think overall in Europe, I think we saw even more the government intervening even more than here. Like, we had not a single bank collapse. I mean, not really. Like, everyone got bailed out except for Cyprus. Mm-hmm. Like, here, at least, I believe some major companies went bust in the 2008 financial crisis, and not in Europe.
Yeah, let a couple go. Lehman, Salomon Brothers.
They, like, kind of went fake bust, right?
Yeah. Let a couple of the old heads die.
And, like, a lot of gobbles. There was a lot of gobble-ups.
Yeah, the consolidation. It was more of a bank consolidation play.
And we had massive bailouts, too.
Yeah. $2 trillion. Or, yeah.
It's the simplicity. It's not just, it's like just 21 million. It's just so simple.
It's simple, yeah.
When all this shit's going flying around, you know, you just, 21 million.
Yeah. And so you got reintroduced in 2013 at this course in Holland, but you said you spent some time in Cyprus too, correct?
Yeah, yeah. So then after my bachelor's, I did my master's in Cyprus. And this was the master's in digital currency. It's hosted by the University of Nicosia. It is completely remote, but as a kid, we went on holidays a lot in Cyprus, and I was like, well, you know, actually, that would be a nice place to live, at least for a year or so. And that's what I did. I met a bunch of the staff at the university, but none of the lecturers, because everyone is remote. Like, there's people from the US teaching, and from Australia, all over.
Would you recommend the class?
Yes.
Yeah.
You're probably, like, one of the oldest, like, master's recipients of digital currency.
Well, no, because I only graduated last July or so.
Oh, okay.
So there have been a couple of cohorts before me.
Yeah, I think they launched in, like, 2014 or something like that.
Yeah, that's right.
What was the course like? What was the structure of it?
So basically, you start a new class every 8 weeks. It's just one class at a time, so that really helps with the focus. You start off with a money and banking course, so you really look into, like, you know, what the current financial system is, and then you move on to a class called open financial systems, where you kind of reinvent the currently existing business models in the financial industry, and, like, try to figure out something that could be decentralized or could be done on top of Bitcoin.
So did you run into a lot of bad ideas of people trying to decentralize things that probably shouldn't be?
Oh, yes, absolutely. So I tried to do, like, a stupid blockchain project, like, in the supply chain. And I was like, at the end of the, like, you compose a nice report, but then in the end of the class, I was like, this is not going to work.
Why?
I mean, we were, like, so in Europe, you've got these, like, way bills. You also have them in aviation for cargo. We also have it for road logistics. So I was trying to, like, put those on a blockchain and, like, make it better. But at the end of the day, someone still needs to put that data on the blockchain. So you there's really no use of it.
I think, did you guys see the Blockstream clip they did? Like, the parody clip of, like, the timestamps being on every, like, water bottle and thing to illustrate what it would be like to blockchain the supply chain. It's hilarious thinking that you would need to, like, use proof of work to hash some data to prove that a water bottle got to you from a certain supplier.
That's just silly.
Yeah. No, but I we should find that video and post a link, because it's a very good visualization of how stupid blockchaining the supply chain is. I'm sorry.
Is it an older link?
It's the last 3 months, I'm pretty sure. I think it was like an April. I think it was an April Fool's thing, maybe.
Oh, I turned off the internet. Especially in the fucking Bitcoin industry, it's the worst. It's the worst day of the year.
Yeah.
Because you already don't know what's real and what's not real. Like, someone could actually be fucking tokenizing water bottles or something, and you would have no idea. I think Coinbase, like, actually launched a real product on April Fool's, which is, it's the exact issue. It's like, you have no idea what the hell is going on.
Especially with Coinbase.
I tune off. Yeah. I don't participate.
Back to this master's class. So, like, economic theory, projects, like, how you may decentralize, like, then... Are you diving into, like, the nitty-gritty code of how to...
Yeah, so I took the, like, it's not really computer science, but they have two tracks. One is more, like, financial, and one is more, computer science. Mm-hmm. So I did that one. You look a bit into cryptography. That's one course, and there's a programming course. I'm not a developer myself, but I did take that course, and it was hard. It was my lowest grade of the whole master's, but I actually learned the most, so it was really good.
Awesome.
So what do you think you learned over this master? Like, how did your perspective of this stuff shift over the course of your master's program?
Were you already a Bitcoiner when you went to the master's?
Yeah, I was.
Oh, okay.
Well, for one, so I did my bachelor and master's at normal universities back in Holland. And, you know, you get all those micro and macro economics courses. And, like, just in the very first course in the degree in Cyprus, I was like, oh, actually, there's more. Like, I had never heard of the Austrian School of Economics until I came there. So yeah, that was big.
It's another common trope between Bitcoiners.
Yep.
It is fascinating, though, how this is a broken record at this point on Tales from the Crypt, but it's fascinating. Somebody who studied economics myself, and you get a degree, and you don't even think about it while you're getting that degree, but you're supposed to have like a well-rounded knowledge of the subject, yet you're only force-fed a very, very thin sort of school of thought behind the whole encompassing subject.
I just find it weird that they only teach you Keynes, and they don't even tell you that there's other things. Like, in normal universities.
It's just the way it is.
Yeah.
It's the way it is.
It's the right way.
According to them, it's reality, but...
Don't even get me started. I've been triggered enough on this podcast the last month and a half talking about central bankers. Matt.
So you got intro to Austrian after Bitcoin.
Yeah.
I feel like Bitcoin really, it almost like memifies Austrian because it
in a way,
it makes it so simple to understand because it's just what it used to be. That used to be just like a theoretical case study. What happens if you had a perfectly fixed supply of just this number, and that's it. It's just fixed. But now that's real, and I think a lot of people, like, they see it, they understand the value of that just straight fixed supply first, and it really opens up Austrian economics to them in the first place.
Yeah, no, and it's Satoshi early on, I forget, it was the mailing list or Bitcoin Talk, sort of said this will probably appeal to the libertarian Austrian school very innately and sort of attack that demographic to help bootstrap the network. And it just makes sense. And again, going back to like not being taught in schools, that's the other great thing about Bitcoin is it forces you to get a master's degree. So let's get back to that. Like the comp sci part of it, do you think you would be able to have built Bittr without this program?
I don't know if I would have gotten the idea.
Okay.
But I mean, I'm still hiring external developers to actually build it. But yeah, the idea definitely came out of the master's degree. So in the very first course, Money and Banking, we had to think of just one financial industry company that could be done on top of Bitcoin. And back when I lived in the US, I was using Acorns back in 2011. And I was like, there should be something like this for just to do Bitcoin. I mean, you don't need to invest in all the other shitcoins, but just Bitcoin. And then like doing the recurring buys, doing your change automatically, invest that in Bitcoin. And what I also like about Acorns is they team up with kind of like what Lolly does. Like they team up with other companies and they say like, oh, if you spend like $1,000 with us, we invest $50 back into your Acorns account, stuff like that. And I was like, well, actually that should be done for Bitcoiners. And so with Bittr, I started just with the recurring buys, but like that's kind of like the long-term vision that I have. Just Acorns, but then for Bitcoin.
And so what's the mechanics of building that product been like? Like acquiring the Bitcoin, divvying it out after purchases and stuff like that.
So the mechanics of how Bittr works nowadays?
Yes.
So basically we just automatically check our bank accounts every hour. And then we check for new transactions. If the incoming transactions is from a customer that we've already signed up in the past, they just go through automatically up into a certain amount. We place the buy order at either Kraken or Bitstamp. And then from our own wallet, we pay out the Bitcoin directly into the customer's wallet. And at the end of each business day, we just reconcile the balances and add up funds in Kraken and Bitstamp and to our own Bitcoin wallet, basically.
Do you have special deals with those exchanges where they're like, we know you're going to provide some volume, so
No, but it's just volume based anyway. So like on Kraken, the fee drops with every 50,000 euros of volume.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So how's
you said you've been working on this for 2 years, but you were able to go live in August of 2018, correct?
Yeah, that's right.
So what were sort of the hurdles that you saw and stuff like that?
I mean, I started this during my studies still, and I probably spent about 6 months with the developers to build the whole product. And I was like, in April, like, oh yeah, I'm ready to go. So I, went to the, this agency that you register a company with in Holland. And I thought, okay, next step is getting a bank account. And I was like, oh, that's pretty difficult if you're a crypto company, because all of the major Dutch banks, they were, from the like very, very first appointment, they were like, no, you're not getting an account with us. Just no. And there was like one that's like kind of like a startup bank, like it's a bit more modern. They only have an app. There's no physical branches. And they promote themselves as crypto-friendly banks. So I was like, yeah, I should try them. They have a nice API too. So that's great for Bittr. And it took some time, but eventually they did give me an account.
What bank is this?
Bunk.
Bunk?
Bunk. B-U-N-Q.
B-U-N-Q. Yeah. Nice. So I guess that's something that I'm interested in as an American. Like, and that's something, being in New York State too, that's something we talk about, is like regulatory hurdles a lot, and with Bitfinex being in the news a lot lately too.
And we have the Bit license here, which makes it really difficult, extra difficult to get a bank account.
Yeah, I think that's funny. Like on some crypto platforms, when you sign up, it's like you have to put a checkbox like, oh, I'm not from Cuba, right. Sudan, or Iraq, or whatever.
Or New York.
Or New York State.
I think that makes us feel. It makes us feel horrible.
Well, no, the one like, it was like North Korea, Iran, and New York State.
Yeah,
one.
Exactly. Yeah. In Cuba, or whatever.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
So in Europe, it's a bit vague at the moment. For example, I've asked my central bank, so the Central Bank of Holland, like, what do you guys think? Do I need to do a license for this? And they're like, nope, not yet. We don't regulate it. So that's a bit strange. But starting from January 2020, there's like a new update for the European legislation on this anti-money laundering stuff. And then then we'll be able to apply for a license.
And it's like not that bad, right?
I don't know yet. I mean, for the KYC, we still need to do that because our bank requires it to do it. Like, there's no way that we can offer our service without doing some KYC.
Right. So I feel like we kind of like skipped over what Bittr was a little bit. Right.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
You tweeted at us, right? That's how we discovered each other. And immediately going to your website, I love like the simplicity of it. It's just, you register an address, right? The customer registers an address with you. And then anytime they transfer money to your bank account, you buy the equivalent amount of Bitcoin and send it to them. Did I get that right?
Exactly. Yeah, it's that simple.
They don't have to register like what time they're sending it or anything. No. They just send it to you. And you
I'm not doing anything for the customer until they send me their money. So it's not like they have a subscription. They're free to come and go whenever they want, and I like that kind of product.
Why did you pick this setup in particular?
Because I thought the way to do dollar cost averaging on Coinbase is horrible. Like, nobody makes the effort to actually withdraw the coins. So it's like, I mean, you have Bitcoin and people are storing it massively at a massive Bitcoin bank, which is Coinbase. Like, I thought I should do that better, hence Bittr.
I think it's such an awesome, it's such a cool setup because you don't have to worry about custodying their Bitcoin.
I don't want to take that risk.
Yeah, exactly. It makes it so much lighter on you. And on their end, they can just, whatever their bank, they just set reoccurring payments if they want to do reoccurring or whatever order they want to do, and they can just do it.
And also on the website, there's nothing like a customer portal. So, I mean, I hope it'll never happen, but if I get hacked, like, the most I could lose is my own Bitcoin. Like, there's never any customer data exposed on the website.
How about, like, the KYC, all the KYC data, stuff like that?
Yeah.
The
KYC data is stored offline. The addresses are obviously in my database because otherwise I can't operate. Right. But that's not exposed to the website.
Yeah, that's the one we've been talking to Michael from Noddle. That's the one question he had is about reusable addresses and adding the functionality to be able to dump a bunch of addresses to help with that obscurity.
Yeah. So when I designed the product, I was like, I want it to be as simple as possible. Like, I want to know as little as feasible about the customer, but I also want to make it, like, you know, as easy for them as possible. So I just figured four steps. First step, email address, then the phone number, Bitcoin address, and then done. Like, that's it. Now, being almost like almost a year live, I found quite a bit of people requesting for like the possibility to enter an XPub key, so that, you know, for every deposit I could use a new address in your wallet. But I was like, oh, I don't want to have people's XPub keys, because then I could, like, I mean, not that I'm interested, but just the fact that I have that information bothers me.
You could see every transaction.
Exactly. I don't want to do that. So now I've thought about a bit more about it, and I'm thinking that, you know, if people are responsible and they enter an XPub key that hasn't been used yet, that at least says that it was empty when they signed up. And I can check, I can like verify if it was empty when they sign up. So that's what I'm going to do and implement it that way. So before actually paying out to any of those addresses, I'm first going to check if that XPub was ever used. If it's used, I'm just not going to take it.
I like that. So they can't accidentally expose their past transactions, and you just hope the customer is smart enough to just understand, like, that's their Bittr wallet.
Yeah.
And they should transfer out of that so that that XPub doesn't show any other. It's a nice, simple way to do it, I think.
I think it's the best alternative. Like, at the moment, it's address reuse, which is not great. Getting people's XPub is also not great. But then again, like, for some merchant for some merchant providers, they also do that, so that they can pay out to every new address.
Yeah, I guess like the issue would be with the single addresses is that if someone is watching that address, if they figure out what that address is, they can see how much Bitcoin you're buying.
Yeah,
you can just easily track how much Bitcoin you're buying. So like that's why, this XPub idea would be a big improvement, I think.
No, but I think this particular product feature highlights the sort of push and pull between users and builders, who you're trying to take in as little data as possible. Users want as much functionality as possible. So it's having that conversation with your user base, like, all right, what are we comfortable with? Like, and how, I guess the question I'm leading into is like, how do you try to explain these trade-offs like within the product?
That's a bit difficult. I mean, I still want my mom to be able to use the service. So I'm going to leave the sign up as it is today, but then on the page where I would normally ask the user's Bitcoin address, I would just add a button like, hey, if you know what you're doing, you can enter an XPub key here,
like the advanced button, whatever.
Exactly.
I think that's a nice balance.
That is,
because I really love how simple your service is. It's like the ultimate stacking sats. Like,
reminds me of Azteca a little bit. Obviously,
With the bank account instead of cash.
Yeah, exactly. That's incredible. And that's like one that we've been pumping stacking sats here on this podcast. We stack sats with Cash App here in the States, but I think so, like, in Europe you're saying Coinbase was the only thing. How many other like Bittr like products are there?
Well obviously there's nobody doing it exactly my way, being non-custodian. But I guess like there's, in every European country there's usually like a brokerage firm. They would probably offer like a recurring buy option, but then they're always going to be custodian.
Yeah.
It's almost like similar to like, I feel like how like an OTC would be set up.
Yeah.
Like OTC relationship, but with actual end users that anyone can. So it's, you're available all of Europe?
Yeah.
Anywhere in the EU?
Yeah. I'm currently talking with the German regulator. So it's not available in Germany yet, but it should be soon.
So everywhere but Germany in the EU. Awesome.
Yeah. Oh, thank you for building this. It's crazy that you're a one-man team building this.
I mean, when back in university, it was actually two of us working on it. The guy I was working with during the studies was a bit older, had a family, and he got a really good job offer for one of the major Polish brokerage/exchange companies. So he went there. Then I first tried to find someone else to do it with, but I just couldn't. And I was like, I need to get going. Like, needs to be built.
And you've been bootstrapping this bitch too, haven't you?
Yeah.
How's that been?
I mean,
this is a conscious decision, right? to Bootstrap instead of...
Yeah, I mean, I don't like, you know, over planning everything and like, oh, we need a lot of money and like get investors on board and get a whole team set up. It's like, no, it's a super simple service. I'm just gonna see if it works, if people actually want this, and we can always grow. Like, it, at the moment, the most time I spend on is like verifying new customers and doing a bit of customer support, but and that's like the only thing that would require more people at the moment.
I think this is a very underappreciated mindset in the world right now, especially the VC world that we're in. Like, the fact that you're able to bootstrap this is sort of ingenious way of getting Bitcoin to people is is a case study in like, hey, you don't need to go raise $8 million to provide utility in this.
Yeah, space. No ICO is necessary.
Yeah, and you're stacking sats on your own because of this. You're like basically an easy way to accumulate Bitcoin.
Yeah, true.
But you haven't been through a bull market yet. Bittr hasn't been through a bull market yet.
That's right? True. Yeah. So, yeah.
You remember last bull market. Last bull market, things got crazy.
Yeah.
Customer service, you had to scale up.
Yeah, so that's a good segue into like, how do you plan on scaling up? And how, or before we even get to plans on scaling up, how have things been up to this point? How are users interacting with Bittr?
Well, at first it was a bit slow because nobody knew about the service, obviously. But then one of the guys in my co-working space in Lisbon suggested like, yeah, you should just integrate it with existing wallets because I like your service, but it's just too much work to go to a separate website for it. And like, so yeah, that's what I did. I reached out to Trezor and Ledger, and the guys from Trezor were like, kind of like you are, like, oh, this is great. We should integrate it. So that's been bringing in a lot of new customers the last 2 months.
Wait, how's the integration? How does that work? Is it in their web wallet?
Yeah. So
they have the exchange tab on it.
Yeah, there's a bunch of places where you can buy with your like credit card, Visa or MasterCard, and then all the way at the bottom, unfortunately, but I'm still happy. There's an option to buy recurrently via SEPA, which is like the European payment system.
Awesome.
And that's Bittr.
And you're the only one listed there.
Yeah.
Under the SEPA. Awesome.
That's a big comment. Congrats on that.
Thanks.
How have users been using the platform? Like, do you have a lot of recurring users, monthly active users coming back?
I would say the majority of my users buy weekly.
Mm-hmm.
I have only 5 people that buy daily, but I mean, that's great. And then there's a couple that buy monthly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow, the daily buy is an interesting one.
That's perfect dollar cost averaging.
Yeah, it's literally, yeah, daily. I mean, at that point, well, you can get down to the hour, right?
In theory, yes. Yeah. That's a bit crazy.
Daily is pretty crazy.
I mean, your bank won't let you do hourly payments.
True.
Like, the minimum with a standing order with the bank is daily.
Yeah, that'd be a little bit ridiculous.
So it's, yeah, like, it seems like you haven't done any marketing at all, or like a lot of marketing at all.
No, just a bit of random stuff on Twitter, like reaching out to you guys, for example. But the Trezor thing has helped me most.
I think the TFTC pump is going to be bigger than the Trezor pump.
You're going to love this one. Our European freaks, they've been waiting, you know, because we keep shilling Cash App.
Yeah,
and it's
not available for us.
Yeah, exactly. So they've been waiting for something, and I think this is a really good fit.
Yeah, I think it's an incredible fit. So let's talk about going into the future. Like, as you scale up, it's a very simple product right now. Do you think there's beauty in its simplicity and it doesn't need much tweaking other than adding features that customers are asking for?
Yeah, I think it's that simple, really. Yeah. Like, in the long run, I still have this vision, like, oh, it should be like Acorns, you know, where we can also look into people's bank accounts and then add up every transaction to, like, the nearest number, like rounding them up. That's what Acorns does, and I think it's really nice way to buy Bitcoin, like very small amounts and you don't really notice it. But I've been looking into it a little bit, and it's kind of difficult because you've got, as a business, you have transaction fees for SEPA transactions. So like, if you're taking, I don't know, like 40 cents as a roundup, I mean, all my margin is gone within the fixed fees. So
yeah.
It's kind of difficult to make the experience for the consumer still like, oh yeah, it's actually rounding up the numbers. Because like, obviously you could take all the all the roundups at the end of the month, but then people still see it as like, oh, I'm spending like 60 euros on
material.
Yeah. It defeats the psychology.
Exactly.
You need like bank integrations and stuff.
Yeah, right? But that's getting pretty easy because I mean, in well, supposedly this year already we're supposed to have PSD2 regulations, which allow third-party companies to look into people's bank accounts.
In Europe,
yes. So that's not the difficult part. The actual difficult part is moving the money. And not.
I remember we had something like that in America for a little bit. Lawnmower. Do you remember Lawnmower?
Yeah, Lawnmower. Yeah, Lawnmower. That's yeah. Like...
They went out of business, I think.
But
it was
why?
Like Acorn for Bitcoin.
I think they were a little too early.
Yeah, they were too early. And I think there was a lot of... In America, it's a lot more difficult to integrate with the different banks and see everything.
Oh, yeah, true.
So I think that was, you know, they had to pour a ton of money into that, and that didn't work out well.
Yeah. For Bittr, it's also like I started with this most simplistic component, which is the recurring byte.
Yeah, I almost like that. It's just, it's so much cleaner. You know, it's like, this is how much money I'm putting in, converting into Bitcoin, you know, on a daily, weekly, monthly, whatever basis. Like, I'd be all about that in America. Like, that would be, that's the ideal. It's just super simple. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, and I think, moving forward, like, is there anything, I guess let's talk about more about the mechanics of Bittr, like, in the Bitcoin side of things. Like, are you batching transactions? Are you looking forward to Schnorr and being able to, like, one sig send out multiple outputs and stuff like that? Like, scaling on the Bitcoin side and then the infrastructure side on the traditional banking.
Yeah, so we've been batching from the very start. Like, I've always thought, like, yeah, it's stupid to pay out all the separate transactions. And something we've only been doing this for the last month, but I really like the idea, is that we pay out with super low transaction fees, so like 1 or 2 Satoshi per byte transactions. And then they all add up to each other. So, you know, we're spending our unconfirmed change and we'll keep doing that. And then at the end of the day, or like more like, at the end of next business day, if the transactions are still unconfirmed, then I'm just spending like a little bit bigger transaction to myself, and that's going to confirm all the transactions from the past day. Nice. So it's like really cheap for the customer because the customer is paying the transaction fee, the mining fee.
That's creative.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
I've
child pays your parent.
That's a
great idea.
Yeah.
And it just confirms on its own, and then you don't even have to worry about it.
Yeah, then it's also good.
And it's perfect for this use case, which is like the small
reoccurring
buy.
People are not in a rush with the Bitcoin they buy through me. Like, if they would be in a rush, they'd go somewhere else.
Do you have like a daily? Is it like a daily clearing time where you send out all your withdrawals, or
no? It's every hour.
Every hour.
Yeah.
Are we gonna is like Bittr gonna start having the BitMEX effect on the mempool?
Wait, so BitMEX at 9 a.m. this time, BitMEX sends out all their transactions at the same exact time. So the fees go up. The fees go up because they only send out their big transactions all at once.
Well, yeah, mine are every hour, and I mean I'm not increasing my own transaction fees, so
every hour is probably better in terms of like transaction fee spikes.
This is going to be a good problem to have too, by the way.
Yeah, like that's a volume problem.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah.
No, that's great. That's fantastic. I like that idea of keeping fees as low as possible.
So it seems like Bittr is like a beautifully simple and elegant product. Like, outside of Bittr, like, what other types of stuff would you like to build for Bitcoin?
Good question.
We
just built an awesome ass product.
I know, Mom. That's not enough. We need more.
Well, we need
What's
more.
Next?
Oh, well, I don't have my next great idea yet.
So not your next great idea. What's something that you're looking for or looking forward to being built out, whether it's Bitcoin at the protocol level or sort of utilities on top of Bitcoin? Putting you on the spot.
Yeah, I'm thinking.
I think Lightning Network payouts, man. Like, are you thinking about that on your?
Oh, that's a good point.
On your roadmap at all? Is that?
Yeah. So I was thinking with the other part of Bittr that we were discussing previously, with the rounding up of people's trend of people's normal spending, to pay out those via Lightning, because they're super small. Like, we're talking basically 1 to 99 euro cent payments. Like, that's going to be too expensive to do on chain. So that would be really cool to do via Lightning. I mean, I think it's the only way to do it through Lightning. And then we really get to stacking sets. Like, it's just a few sets at a time.
Here's three sets. You know, like, that'd be awesome.
It's like, you talk about efficiencies a lot in Bitcoin. Like, services like this help make the price appreciation as efficient as possible, I would argue, right?
It's infrastructure. And it's, like, my favorite kind of infrastructure because it doesn't rely on any custodial. That doesn't exist. Does anyone else, I don't know, except for, like, OTC desks, once again. Is like, I don't know anyone else who's doing like a non-custodial Bitcoin on-ramp.
I mean, again, ask
I guess
Techo.
Like local Bitcoins, HODL.
Yeah.
But in different ways. This is like seamless. Like you're not getting like a seller like on local Bitcoins or something and then having to send to a different person. Like you just always send to the same account. I have a question. What are your fees? Like what do
oh,
you
Oh yeah,
take?
we should have talked about this much earlier. Yeah. So it's just 1.5% and Bitcoin mining fee, which I try to keep at a minimum.
Right, as you said. Cool. That's nice and low. And I guess we already said who told us. Michael said that he really likes, he sent us a screenshot of what your breakdown looks like. And it's really nice how you really lay out what fees are being taken, what exchange rate is being taken. It's
That's
nice
a good point, actually. So in the very first version of Bittr, it was just showing like the incoming euro amount and the outgoing Bitcoin amount, and those divided by each other. So that was like kind of showing an exchange rate, but I was like, that's not really fair, because like you're integrating your own fee into it and you're integrating the mining fee into it. Like people should just be able to see what my service costs. Like I hate other platforms that that put their spread inside
they
of the
bake it into the spread.
Yeah, that's nasty. Yeah. Like
I loved how you had it just like written out exactly what paying to the miner, paying to you. That was pretty, you saw that screenshot, that was fantastic.
Yeah. Oh, you've thought through this very very thoroughly. And it's again like improving on the UX, improving on, and that is part of the UX, is something we talk about here a lot, is especially when you're taking Bitcoin in your own hand, your own custody, there's like those moments like, all right, what's happening with my Bitcoin? Why am I only getting, like, what fees were taken out, like we were just talking about?
I have a very simple request. Maybe also, like, list the amount of Satoshis, all right?
Like, instead of, like, 0 points?
You can
both.
Do it in both.
Okay.
You know, because, like, people are comfortable with Bitcoin, so, like, you can tell them just how many Satoshis they've also stacked.
We start out with both, and then slowly over time, you just make it Satoshis only. You start normalizing.
Exactly.
Yeah, we're in a big normalization phase here with making sats, the denomination with which we talk about Bitcoin.
You got to think in sats.
Got to think in sats.
I'm seeing here a Bitcoin piggy bank, and I'm trying to incorporate that more and more inside of Bittr, because I think it's, like, the perfect model. Like, you're putting every week a little bit more into your piggy bank. And I'll make some animation or so that shows sats going into a piggy bank in the email.
I love that.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
Pig gets a little fatter every email.
Yep.
You know?
So what this piggy is, this is BitPiggy.
Shout out Farface 2000.
Yeah, Farface 2000 made them. It comes with an open dime.
Okay.
It comes with an open dime and just QR stickers for the...
the address.
For the address. Mm-hmm. And so like, so then kids can have their little piggy bank.
Nice.
It's pretty cool.
Very very cool interactive way to stack sats in MeatSpace, if you ask me.
I do like the piggy bank. I do like the piggy bank metaphor. I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, it's like every email from Bittr starts with, oh, yay, there's more Bitcoin in your piggy bank.
I saw that. I liked it.
Well, all right, let's get a little cosmic here. This like turns into like why we're into Bitcoin, and this is something that sort of on my mind today. Like a lot of people shitting on Bitcoin for sound money and all that stuff, and we're really, I think, caught in this conspicuous consumption, debt finance lifestyle, and I think small things like helping people realize that saving money is cool and probably worthwhile by incentivizing stacking sats with the piggy bank stuff is important. So like the whole concept of financing your life via debt or capital accumulation is a discussion as a society I think we've gotten away from in a while, and in America here it's becoming more and more like of a topic of conversation, is monetary policy and the stuff, actually the bubbles that we're in. I'm not sure if it's pervasive beyond the Bitcoin bubble.
It's definitely not pervasive at all.
But like, do you see the value in like the sound money of Bitcoin and the like saving aspect that it brings to the world and the store of value?
Yeah, I think that's what attracted me most to it. It's like the fixed limit of 21 million, then it's done, as opposed to, you know, having savings and just seeing them become worth less and less over time. That's just unfair. So I, when I was promoting Bittr before I started building it to some people in the university, I showed a graph, and like I think it only takes 36 years before whatever you have in a savings account is worth half of it. That's crazy. That's insane. Like, that doesn't attract anyone to save, basically. So I think if Bitcoin is working out, then we do have a money that's worth saving.
Yeah. And, I mean,
do you think holding is using?
I actually gave a talk in Lisbon, which I called the HODL problem, because if everyone just HODLs, then nobody builds stuff, and then like Bitcoin is not going to be great by itself. We need people building small, like even a product as simple as Bittr, like we need people to build that.
Right, but we also need people to hold it, right?
Yes, we need both.
Yeah, but I mean, I think this has pretty much been debunked as FUD. I mean, with Dhruv Bansal, shout out on chain and everything they're doing, but Dhruv's HODL waves analysis in particular shows that when the price rises, the distribution of Bitcoins rises, or Bitcoin supply distribution, the Bitcoin supply becomes more distributed because big HODLers are selling. I guess HODLs, I think HODL is important. Like, we need HODLers, obviously, but people spending too doesn't hurt the network, in my opinion.
It's just interesting to me how I feel like it's amazing how frowned upon saving is.
Yeah. You
That's know? Crazy, yeah.
Like, there's no one who's on the store value side of Bitcoin's valuation saying no one should spend. Like, everyone who wants to spend should spend. But there's plenty of people on the opposite side who are like, if you save Bitcoin, if you hold on to it because you think that it will both protect your wealth and actually grow your wealth because we're still in like an adoption phase, then you're wrong. Like, you shouldn't do that. That's not a valid use case of Bitcoin. And I would say, like, right now, like, that's like the most valid use case of Bitcoin.
Yeah, especially in this hyper volatile period where we have price discovery going on.
Yeah, you want to protect your wealth. Like, that's the main, if even and they happen to be speculators too, because if you're trying, you're protecting your wealth, then you're also speculating that it'll go up in price. But like, I think like the key value prop is that like your wealth doesn't lose value, like not even, you know, it makes value. That's even better. But but like that, it won't lose value.
Yeah, you're not going to lose your satoshis. Are not going to depreciate against the whole pie, or become depreciate, or excuse me.
Yeah, one satoshi is one satoshi.
Yeah, exactly.
There you go.
Starting the normalization process. Yeah, I guess just open it up here. What else? You from Holland, live in Portugal now. You studied in the United States. Are you a digital nomad?
Yeah, kind of, but yeah. I don't like the term.
No,
like,
why not?
I think it sounds silly. Like, I'm this hipster digital nomad. No, it's just I move often. Just because I like it.
Yeah.
And I'm not bound to any place. And now, especially with Bittr, it's like, yeah, I mean, I just need my laptop and I can work. Like, recently I was like, ah, it's kind of stupid that people can't enter a BAC32 address. So I looked a bit into the code myself and I was like, yeah, I can fix this. So now, since I think 2 weeks ago, people are able to do it. And I didn't make any announcements. But in my database, I'm seeing a lot of BAC32 addresses.
Straight to Wasabi, and then they can call them. And then that whole problem is solved without Nextpub.
Yeah, actually, this is...
I guess it's not. They can still watch the address, but...
This is another really cool idea a friend of mine told me. That I should only allow my customers to do increments of 25 euros. And then pay everyone in 25 euro increments, so that, you know, whenever someone is trying to do some blockchain analysis, they just see only 25 euro.
That's a great idea. Do that. I like that idea. It's like a massive CoinJoin-esque thing going on.
Yeah, but it's kind of difficult to force the customer because I'm not in control of their payment. So, yeah, you know, I'm not pulling money from their bank account. So it's kind of difficult to be like, okay, you can only do 25, 50, 75, 100. It's
So never mind. It's not.
But I like the idea. It's cool.
It's a nice shower thought. So that's a fun one.
Yeah, that would be dope. You could even like do Satoshis too. You don't even have to do 25 euro, right?
No, like, it has to be euros. Like the euro amount has to be fixed.
The beauty is that it's a push. The beauty of the whole thing is that I'm literally doing nothing on your website.
Yeah.
Except the original setup. Then I just go into my bank's app or whatever, and I just, whenever I send Ruben money, like Bitcoin comes out the other side. Like that's the beauty. The no app, nothing. It's just send it.
And that's also part of the security model. So once people have done a transaction, they can't change their bank account or their address anymore. Because I'm thinking if you were somehow able to change the address through our customer support, then nothing changes on the customer's end in terms of paying. But now like people would like kind of need to have access to their bank account, which like that's not my problem. The bank should protect it. So yeah, it's really secure too by not having anything on our website that can be changed afterwards.
Because if you change, like if like a malicious individual or something changes the address, then the person keeps sending the reoccurring payment, doesn't check the address. Maybe,
exactly,
right?
Because like there's no, I mean, also since recently there's a reference to the Blockstream Block Explorer to like see your transaction that I'm sending with my confirmation emails. Right. But before that, there was like no mentioning of your Bitcoin address. So you would literally not see anything changed and you just keep receiving those emails and you think, oh, I'm getting Bitcoin every week. But in fact, someone else is getting them.
More of a reason to do this XPub thing too, though.
Yeah, true.
Right, because that was like the complaint we heard was that they couldn't change their address. But that makes sense. That's a valid reason not to change it. Just keeps it simple and secure.
And one small other thing that I have heard some complaints about is like, why don't you pull the money from my bank account, which is also a possibility throughout Europe. But the problem there is like consumers can revert those transactions up to 13 months after. So I would need to, you know, well, that's for a start, it's a huge risk on me because if I pay out Bitcoin, they're gone. Like I'm not getting them back. Oh, but a consumer can take their euros back for up to 13 months afterwards. So like that's
similar to ACH here.
Yeah. Wait, but that's not the case if they send it. If they send it,
if they send it, they push the transaction and it's irreversible.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Is it irreversible in the United States?
With ACH,
it is.
If they can pull it from your or push to your account, and
then it's irreversible.
They can pull it from there too.
Yeah. Otherwise, there's like a 5-day clearing if they pull it or something.
Yeah.
I mean, 5 days is okay. It's still risky, but 13 months, that's
right. That's way too risky. Ridiculous. Yeah. That, and then Bitcoin could go through the roof or something, too, in the meantime.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of where I want to go next. I'm trying to think. We've covered Bittr pretty entirely. I guess let's keep talking down like the risk security scenarios that you find yourself in. Like, it's something that we didn't have on the docket that just came out. Like, what else are you thinking of from like an attack vector perspective? What's it like being the one man behind this this project?
I mean, that's not great because I'm actually writing a manual at the moment that I can pass on to someone that explains like the technicalities of the project and like if something were to happen, like for example on my flight here, that someone else would still be able to do the ongoing transactions. But yeah, that's something that's been on my mind only recently with increased volume. I was like, oh, actually there's some serious money going through this company now. Like I should create a backup plan and figure out.
I mean, like you set it up like ideally for this because he doesn't hold much of their dollars or much of their Bitcoin at any given time.
No, it's maximum like, 1 hour.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Like that is like in terms of like Bitcoin businesses, especially Bitcoin businesses that interact with fiat, he's already reduced his attack surface like tremendously.
Do you think this business model will be the first in sort of an explosion of similar like models?
I would expect in a couple of years to see banks integrated. but they would be custodian. So it's like, I mean, not the same.
But they could give you like an address.
They give, but it banks seems are like, not going to do that.
It seems like you found like a sweet spot where
I think so too.
You've eliminated a lot of a lot of custody risk and sort of created a seamless process and seem to be having some happy high value customers already. So. Why did it take so long for this service to come to be? Why do you think?
I don't know. Maybe, like, when I started the project, I thought I would address people that are new to Bitcoin, but that turned out to be quite difficult, because people need to set up their wallet, need to make a backup, and it's kind of hard to do it that way. So for those people, they would be more likely to use Coinbase. And what I'm seeing most of the traffic from is people that, you know, already know Bitcoin and they just want to buy it recurrently. And apparently they didn't find a service to do that either before Bittr.
Yeah. I had a follow-up question. What I like is, this is completely, I guess I'm like, first of all, Marty, usually I'm not in the interviews, but I was just so excited about your product. And like all of that just felt together so beautifully that I was like, I'm absolutely going to join this interview. The second thing is, what's really interesting about Cash App is like, I feel like is you can have your paycheck get direct deposited into your Cash App account, and then buy Bitcoin.
Via ACH.
Yeah, via ACH. I think that your service basically allows anyone to get paid in Bitcoin that wants to get paid in Bitcoin without ever getting paid in Bitcoin. Because like if their paycheck comes in like on like a Friday, then they just set like their reoccurring Ruben send like over to Bittr, and whatever portion of their salary that they get in automatically gets converted to Bitcoin. So like basically like anyone in Europe right now can get paid in Bitcoin without their boss ever knowing they're getting paid in Bitcoin, right?
Thank you for your service.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's very cool. And I remember what I wanted to touch on is like, so it seems like a lot of people haven't come up, like it seems like it took 10 years almost for your business idea to come out because people sort of approach the way these products should be built from like a traditional financial mindset, and you're saying like while you're at that master's program you're looking for use cases that Bitcoin would be unique for, and this seems to be one of them. So yeah. I guess what we could talk about here is like a lot of people I would argue have like these blinders on in front of them, like approaching products from like a traditional banking system fintech perspective, and what opportunities has Bitcoin opened up that sort of you're leveraging. And
yeah, but as a Bitcoiner, you look the other way around. It's like, yeah. I want a service that fits my needs, not the one that serves the needs of the banks. Yeah. It's still like, I do think that Bittr is only a temporary company. Like, I don't know in how many years, but it won't be necessary anymore to do the conversion. So it's not like an eternal company, but that's okay.
Yeah, that's why we're waiting to hear your next idea. No, I think you're... Bittr highlights an inherent design, first principles design flaw that a lot of people have when approaching Bitcoin. Like, you can get creative with it. Like, you don't need to custody the Bitcoin.
Yeah.
You just need to set up these ramps for like, hey, I'm the dude who sends you Bitcoin when you send money to this address. And so I think that's one thing I want to highlight in this interview is you're thinking of unique ways that Bitcoin can be leveraged that I don't think people have been thinking about up to this point. Enough people.
Yeah. I love like, just like the super simple tools. You know, it's just, it's super simple. He collects his VIG. It like operates like on Bitcoin's like greed system, basically, where like he gets paid to offer everyone else an additional service. And all of a sudden Bitcoin gets like a beautiful additional on-ramp.
And, yeah, and it's even a little bit cheaper than Coinbase does it. At least in Europe.
Isn't Coinbase 1.5%?
I think it's 1.5% on the conversion, but they have another fee added there afterwards, which is also 0.5%, so it ends up being 2, I think. That's last time I checked.
Right. Yeah, they like hide it a little bit too.
Yeah,
yeah, they like make it like a little bit confusing, but either way, like, fuck Coinbase. So you know,
yes, delete Coinbase.
Yeah, you have that. You have that advantage. Dude, and then like Kraken, like you just have to like actually like, I'm pretty sure you have to actually like set a limit order, like on, like use it like a traditional exchange. You can't just like press buy Bitcoin.
You can. It's a market
on
order.
Kraken?
Yeah.
But yeah, you'd have to like literally, you'd have to open up the order book and do a market order.
Yeah, yeah, but it's all through their API that is done.
Right, no, but I'm saying, not for you, I'm saying like, just a typical European.
Oh,
right? Like
yeah,
that,
I mean that.
I feel like that is a, is,
I get you.
I've tried to, so I have a older coworker in my meat space business that wanted to get into Bitcoin and, you know, fuck Coinbase. And Cash App is app only. And he's not an app dude. He can't do apps. So no, like I tried to onboard him onto Gemini, right?
Oof, okay.
And with Gemini, there's no brokerage element to it. Like Coinbase has a brokerage element where like you can just like buy Bitcoin. Gemini, you have to like open up the order book and like place like a market order to buy. And that is like a, people don't like that are in this space don't realize, but that's a major UX hurdle. Like that bothers people.
I think my mom can use Bittr. She wouldn't be able to use Kraken.
Right. But she could probably use Coinbase.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Is your mom using Bittr?
Not at the moment.
No.
You got to get your parents on board. You got to show it to them.
My dad is. My mom isn't.
There you go.
But,
my parents, I'm still trying to sell them.
Oh, my dad's. He's in the rabbit hole.
Try to get the Bitcoin Rabbi book. I ordered a bunch, but I haven't read it yet.
Actually, I got it waiting for me downstairs. It just arrived.
Yeah. Oh, I want to see it too.
I haven't ordered yet, confession. I'm going to.
I must confess too, be a good boy here. I did not order it. Bitcoin Rabbi sent me one.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
I did read it, but I didn't like hold it. Like I read it in PDF form.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fantastic.
Yeah.
That's going to onboard a lot of new people.
Potentially, yes. Yeah, a lot of new kids.
I don't know if this is going to be a controversial statement or not.
It's probably going to be a controversial statement, just say it.
Might be more influential than the Bitcoin standard.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Whoa. Okay.
It really hit home. It just like... It dove in. It just like and just hit you right.
Yeah, it did. It's very.
I mean, it was like 10 pages versus like 300.
Yeah, I mean, Masir Mamadov. that's who held it up. Masir held it up at Columbia University. I talked about this in the previous podcast, but butchered the thing. But he held up like the Bitcoin Rabbi's book, the children's book behind Columbia University. It was like, I learned more from this children's book than I did at this university the last 4 years. The more educated, like again, like we were talking about this on Rabbit Hole Recap right before you hopped in here. Like, it seems like the on ramps are being built out, the education's being refined. It's like, what can stop Bitcoin at this point? Which I think is a good question for you. Like, what worries you about Bitcoin? What scenario can you see Bitcoin failing?
Well, I was a little bit scared for the new EU regulations that were going to affect crypto companies, but then looking at it, it's like we're doing what they're asking for already because our banks ask us to do it. So it was like, okay, that'll do. But if they would have like crammed down on all the on and off ramps, then that would have, I think, hurt Bitcoin. Because if all those people that buy Bitcoin through me now have to, you know, only use cash to get it, it's going to be a lot more difficult.
Yeah. So I mean, that's the big sort of overarching topic about Bitcoin's biggest hurdles going forward is state clamping down. Do you see a scenario in which like states compete for Bitcoiners? Like, do you think EU regulation is fighting against US regulation right now, is fighting against Latin American, African?
It will probably be smaller nations. Like, I think there's already a little bit of that going on in Georgia, where they're pretty crypto friendly. And
let's dive into that. What's going on in Georgia?
I don't know the particulars, but I've heard that it's welcoming to, like, you can buy property with Bitcoin. And
yeah, Belarus just announced they want to do...
Georgia's Bitfury. They love Bitcoin over there. They have hydro. They have, like, massive hydro. I'm, like, 99% sure they have massive hydro, and they
it seems like,
get to convert into
it
money.
It seems like Eastern Europe's, like, on top of it, like HODL has the Riga conference. They've got a nice presence over there. Belarus,
Trezors,
right? Czech Republic, yes.
Czech Republic.
Yeah. And then more particularly, like the governments, like Belarus just came out, so they want to start mining with nuclear energy. Georgia's on top of it. Cyprus on top of it. Is there anything about like Eastern Europe, do you think, in particular, sort of drives people towards Bitcoin?
I couldn't point at a single reason.
No.
I think.
What do you think? Well, Matt?
Actually, maybe in like, for example, there was this study by ING that was like, where is the most interest in Europe in Bitcoin? And Romania was scoring really high. And I was asking my friends there, like, why do you think that is? And they were like, well, we've got so much corruption that we just would rather have our own money and not the government's money.
Yeah, that's what, and also like Soviet bloc countries in general, like they've recently had massive, massive hardship. They understand devaluation of currencies like on a rapid scale, like in recent, super recent history. And the corrupt officials love Bitcoin, right? That's the other thing. It's like not only do the people see the appeal of Bitcoin, like the corrupt officials fucking love it. Like if the US, if they think that Bitcoin is the money, the only money in the world that the US can't get their hands on, like they're gonna flock to it.
I think Bulgaria is like the, like in terms of governments, it possesses the most Bitcoin.
Yeah, because then wasn't that the BTCE? Wasn't that guy hiding in Bulgaria? Was that?
But then they denied it. They denied it afterwards, which would it was be a dark, the smart move.
Was it a dark market or was it BTCE?
It was a dark market, I'm pretty sure.
It was a dark market.
The money that was, it was dark market related, not BTCE related. And then they denied it like a week later. Mm-hmm. It came out like that they had like a shit ton.
I think something like 300,000 Bitcoin or something.
It was a lot. Yeah. It was a lot of Bitcoin. You remember that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then they denied it, which is what I would absolutely do. Like, you do not want that information.
Just sit on it. Just wait. Just wait it out, you know? Stuff's going to happen. You don't have it.
The year is 2050. Like, what country was it? Was it Belarus?
Bulgaria.
It was Bulgaria. The year's like 2050. Bulgaria is like the richest country. Just like, out of like sheer luck and like a little bit of skill, like they were like, "Oh, we'll deny it, and like we'll store it on our treasure or something." You know, and they're just like they didn't store it that well, but they stored it like decently.
I hope they got a multi sig at least.
Yeah. I mean, well, that's like the rumor. Like North Korea holds like a ton of Bitcoin.
Venezuela's mining some. Yeah. That's the other thing. Is like it's Bitcoin's heavy, man. Like if it gets. Could get, I mean, is there such thing as Bitcoin being in the hands of the wrong people? Like a Venezuela government's mining and getting Bitcoin. Is that in the hands of the wrong people, or is the fact that it's an amoral protocol that has no idea how we're using
it? Bitcoin is non-political. Like, I mean, everyone can own it.
Yeah. No, but this is a big, big thing of FUD production. I mean, obviously, I agree with you guys. I'm just trying to play devil's advocate here. This is a big FUD producing sort of a line of thought is, hey, Venezuela's accumulating, North Korea's accumulating, Iran maybe accumulating. Like, how do we get over that PR hump, I guess, is what I'm trying to get at.
By just having enough normal people own Bitcoin.
Right.
It's like, just like why cash works is like, yeah, I mean, there's still a good amount of normal people that have it. And yes, criminals use it too.
Yeah. But I think... I completely agree, but we've obviously, as Bitcoiners, been tasked with, I would argue, a more arduous path to explaining the benefits of Bitcoin, where mining FUD's a big thing, we're boiling the oceans, criminals and drug dealers and terrorists are using it. These are very unique hurdles to Bitcoin and Bitcoiners trying to explain the use case that we have to overcome, and it's always something I'm fascinated to hear people's ideas on. And this is, what are your thoughts on this? What is the best way to just use it, get into normal people's hands, have them use it, and people just won't be able to refute it?
Well, there's also another side to look at that. So nowadays, euros and dollars are is the normal money, but it's also the state's money and the big banks and the big corporations is what use that money. But if all the normal people use Bitcoin, then at some point the governments are just playing their own game with their own money, and like it doesn't affect anyone else. And that's like where I would love to see in the next 20, 30 years.
I love this talk, Ruben. This is the type of talk I'm looking for. Like, and this is something we've been talking about with Wasabi and coin joining in particular, is like, if we want a certain degree of privacy on the network, we need people to participate. You need people to participate in coin joins, and sort of the UTXO set just passed 4% of all transactions were coin joins recently.
I mean, yeah, like, look at it from like Ruben's perspective. Like, so if he goes with his XPub route, right, they, his customers receive it to a new XPub address. So if anyone's watching a specific address, they don't see it happen unless they have the XPub, then they know. And then from that point, he could still presumably track your transactions, whatever you sent to on the blockchain, because he knows your original.
He sent them to you.
Your original address. But if you go through CoinJoin, then Ruben doesn't have to know. You know, like, that helps. That doesn't just help the person who did the CoinJoin. It helps you as well, because you don't want to know.
I don't want to know what my customers do with their Bitcoin. It's none of my business.
Exactly. So that secures it. It helps Bitcoin on two fronts.
Yeah, I completely agree. And it's how do we, like you're saying, your mom doesn't use Bittr yet. She uses. It's probably easier for her to use another exchange.
No, she's just not into Bitcoin yet. She's not into Bitcoin yet. His dad. If she was into Bitcoin, she'd be using Bittr. Like, that'd be a little bit.
That'd be fucked up.
Yeah.
That'd be fucked up. I wonder if my mom listens to this podcast. Mom, if you're listening, I love you.
My dad doesn't know how to download podcasts yet, which is part of my Bitcoin thesis, is they can't even download podcasts yet. wait, you know, they can't get into Bitcoin yet. They'll figure it out.
Yeah. Hour and 5 minutes in here. I want to keep going. We got plenty of time. I guess we should just riff on what's going on right now. Like, what are your thoughts on
what about conferences? Are you guys going to any in the near future?
We're going to Bitcoin 2019.
In San Francisco,
we're going to BitBlock Boom. I'll be at Value of Bitcoin in Belgium.
We'll obviously be here in 2 weeks for Shitcoin Week,
yeah,
which is in New York. We have a massive influx of people.
I feel like we're Winterfell gearing up for the battle of
against the White Walkers. All the White Walkers are going to come into town. It's going to be great. I went to Consensus last year. Yeah.
What were you doing there? Ago.
I got a free ticket.
Okay.
This guy I met at a bar at an after party. The after parties are good. Yeah. The after parties are good.
I thought you said African party first. I was like, what? No.
Well, you were talking about African crypto regulation or whatever, and I was like, there's no regulation. But
they just outright ban it.
But he gave me a ticket that he found in the trash. So like, I went. It was actually really fun because I went as like an Ernst & Young employee, because that was the guy's ticket who he threw in the trash. He only went for the first day. So the second day I actually went. Like, all the blockchain, not Bitcoin people were, like, coming up to me because I was the E&Y guy, you know? Like, I was I was a Bitcoiner in disguise. So it was, like, extra shit corny.
Did you get your blockchain socks from EY?
No, I just had the ticket from the garbage. Like, they didn't give me, like, the swag bag and shit.
We don't get media passes here at TFTC. We have to dig through the garbage to get our conference.
It's an honor. It's an honor.
No, but it is... It's funny. It'll be interesting to see how well received Consensus is this year.
We're going to Riga too, right?
Why are you guys not going to Breaking Bitcoin in Amsterdam?
Maybe. I love Amsterdam.
You should come.
The freaks not. It'll
be
fun.
I'm going to be in Munich that week, so I may hop over to Amsterdam for that.
Maybe I'll do that.
Yeah. We're doing a dinner the Thursday before. I think it's the 6th.
Okay.
So
the 6th of what?
June.
Of June.
I think the conference is 7 and 8. Okay. But, so if anyone's interested, they can just message me on Twitter for a steak dinner.
Awesome.
Picking a steak here.
I know. Now I'm getting FOMO. I love Amsterdam is probably the second best city in the world after New York, I would say.
I can't attest. I've never been.
You've never been, but I've recorded podcasts from there, and that was a great podcast. I was just like on a canal. You know, it's like beautiful. It's like, I fucking love it.
And Ruben was kind enough to bring some stroopwafels with him.
Oh, yeah. Some Dutch specialties.
I'm excited to dive into those. Not yet, but we're about to get attacked with shitcoiners in this city. I guess that's another topic.
Good luck.
Yeah. So somebody who studied, and again, you said you tried that supply chain thing. Like, how many how long do you think it will take for people to sort of come to grips with how these networks are very limited in their abilities and probably only work for very limited use cases?
Not so long anymore, I think. No. I hope, but to be honest, like, a lot of the other students in my cohort, they're like, I would only know like one. I was with 14 of us, and there's only one other guy that's like a true Bitcoiner. All the others are like still, I mean, some are employed, some are looking for like blockchain related jobs, which I...
No, that's one thing I ponder about or think on a lot too, is like, how many more of these altcoin cycles can we have? Is there like a price point at which Bitcoin hits, a threshold that Bitcoin hits where it's like, all right, they're probably...
We give up.
It's not even we give up. It's not even we give up. It's we submit. Like,
if we submit,
it's
yes.
Probably not likely that something will overtake this. Because that's like a lot of the banter that goes on, particularly with crypto traders, people that are trading these markets, is like, ah, these altcoins are going to be around forever. But there has to be a psychological price point, at least in my mind, where people say, all right, probably won't be a Bitcoin 2.0 if it's reached this market cap and is this saturated. Not a question, just a random thought to put out there.
Do you have anything to say about this, Ruben?
Well, I just hope that sooner or later that you can just go to any conference and just not meet any blockchain people. Just Bitcoiners.
I don't think that will happen anytime soon.
So you were at Riga last year.
Yeah.
Was that your first conference?
No.
Oh. How great is it, like, going to these conferences?
It's amazing.
That you,
just like these people that you follow on Twitter that you have no idea who they actually are, and you just like meet them in person during these conferences.
It's so weird, but awesome, but weird. Really,
yeah, it's
weird.
Really,
it's really,
and it's
really
just
weird.
A few conferences like Breaking Bitcoin, Baltic Honey Badger.
Yeah, you have to be selective.
Yeah,
because most of them are absolutely garbage, right? Yeah.
Even last year, I went to Bitcoin Expo in Boston. I just like going back to Boston because I studied there a few years ago.
We're going to Boston next week. Yeah.
Oh, nice. Yeah. I went again this year and I was like, it's not as diehard Bitcoin as it was a year ago, which is bad.
Like, it's very VCE.
VCE.
Same with New York. There's a lot of bullshit.
There's a ton of bullshit in the city, but there's also a ton of very good signal in the city too, if you know where to look.
The weirdest part about conferences, like meeting people, especially as a podcaster, and we do like a weekly podcast.
Are we officially podcasters now?
I think so. I guess. I mean, we're first and foremost we're Bitcoiners, and then maybe number four we're podcasters. There's all these other things in our lives that matter that are after Bitcoin, because we're just way too obsessed. But the weird thing is, like, as like a weekly Bitcoin podcaster, is like you meet people and they're like, "I've been talking to you for months. You just never respond to me. I just hear you. I just hear your side. But I know exactly what you're going through. But I have you have no idea what I'm going through. But I know you.
It's
weird, but it's awesome.
It's an awesome experience. I was just thinking of my Twitter bio if I made it Bitcoiner. Comma husband, like put Bitcoin before like being like a husband or something.
Yeah, Definitely not. Don't do that.
It's also true for like me as a guest now on your podcast. Like, I know your voices, but it's kind of weird to see the face with it in real life.
Very underwhelming. Right? Yeah. Very underwhelming.
This
I'm
is
sure.
Our first time hearing your voice. It's like a little bit unfair.
It is not unfair. I love it. This is like my favorite part of it. Like, I wouldn't recognize you until I opened the door. I was like, I know this is Ruben.
True.
That's the thing about beauty of Bitcoiners. Like, we hit it off right away. That's another thing that makes me bullish on Bitcoin, is that I'm not meeting more Bitcoiners makes me think I'm a little less crazy than I thought before I met a new Bitcoiner. It's like, all right, you seem like a very rational person, a very smart person, a well-put-together person who knows what they're doing. You've come to the same conclusions that I have. And you don't seem like some insane person that's fucking just in this for some.
Well, I think that also shows if you start a company, a Bitcoin company, in like 2018, like bear market, I think that shows your own values. It's like, you're not into this. I mean, because of some crazy hype, you actually believe in this.
Yeah, you either believe in it or you're a fucking idiot. It's like one or the other.
I wouldn't say that, Matt.
I mean, it's one or the other. He's right. He's right. Like, why would you launch in the bear market? You would launch it if you either believed in it or you just were just fucking dumbass.
Yeah. What's it been like launching in a bear market? You think this is like, would you rather launch here than November?
Yeah, this was fantastic because, like, in the beginning, the volume was quite little, but it helped me figuring out, like, small things that I was doing wrong. So, for example, I used to use limit orders on the exchanges, but I actually got burnt once on that because I had paid out the customer and just that order never filled. So, like,
Bitcoin just did Bitcoin.
Yeah, exactly.
Crazy, right?
So,
love it.
That made me change like how we do it, and now we just place market orders and we wait like a couple of seconds to see how many Bitcoin we bought for the customer.
Right. Yeah, definitely better. I think it's way better bear market. If you look at like every company in the Bitcoin space, every single one that's launched in bear markets has done better because every time someone launches in a bull market, they set their expectations like ridiculously high, and it's like not even they might have the best idea ever. But they just get fucked.
You see this a lot with noobs getting like drawn to mining in particular. They'll like get into Bitcoin in a bull run. They'll be like, oh, mining is the next big thing.
Cloud mining. They love cloud mining. I guess cloud mining is kind of a competitor to you.
Why?
Because people view it as I want reoccurring income, right? Yeah, like I'll pay them. This amount of money, and they're going to get their weekly payouts or their daily payouts or something like that.
If they understand mining a little bit, they should know that it's just better to buy than to do it this way.
But no, they don't. They always... 2017, so many people, like decent acquaintances of mine and close friends alike, went with the cloud mining approach. Because it, like, mentally, psychology-wise, like, made sense to them. And I told them, like, a million times, I told them, don't do it. I did it. Don't do it. They can leave with all your money. Even if they don't leave with all your money, you're better off buying it. All these different things. Doesn't matter. They need to go through their, like, little cloud mining phase where they don't make as much money as if they've just bought it. And then they will eventually graduate.
You got to learn. You know, you got to take your lumps. But it's funny. It's funny how it's like almost predictable. Seeing, I've been through two full bull bear markets now. Seeing people come in make the same mistakes you did. It's inevitable almost. And that's what like a lot of people are like, oh, we want to save noobs. I was that guy too. But it's like it's impossible at some point. Like human nature.
No, people just. I mean, it's kind of bad, but it's just like with children. Like they just need to get burned once.
You touch the stove. they have to touch the fucking stove.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we've protected some noobs from not touching the stove to begin with, and that's fucking dope. But I think that the majority will have to, like, we are not at the point, at least Bitcoin is not at the point right now, where the majority of people will come in and they will get burnt first, and then they will ultimately realize that Bitcoin's the best money we've ever had, and then they will start accumulating Bitcoin. Like, I think, like, maybe in the future we'll hit that point. Probably not, but no matter what, like, once you have to take responsibility into your own hands and, like, do your own thing with money, people are going to get burned and they learn along the way.
Yeah, and then they end up on Bittr if they're in Europe. They start buying, stacking sats through that.
Yeah, that's also one of the values I started a company with is, like, I want to promote responsible investment. Like, don't go and buy all of your savings at once. Don't put it into Bitcoin at once. Just do of your own, like, of your work or whatever... of whatever income in euros, just set a little bit aside in Bitcoin.
Yeah, and it's, again, like we touched on this earlier too, like it's changing that mindset of debt-driven conspicuous consumption to, hey, throw a few shekels away every paycheck is a cognitive shift that needs to happen on the planet, not only in this country, but like in the whole fucking planet, the rock that we're flying on right now.
Are shekels a shitcoin?
I don't think. I think shekels were silver, weren't they?
I don't know.
I don't know. They might have been. I think a shekel was like a silver.
Well, silver is a shitcoin anyway. Well, maybe gold will still have value, but silver, like how could silver still have it? I'll have a look a little bit.
I don't have any silver.
Yeah. Not a silver bag holder.
Not a silver bag holder either. Ruben, what interests you outside of Bitcoin?
Traveling.
Traveling?
Yeah. And flying in particular. I love flying.
Why? Why do you love flying? I hate flying.
What airline did you fly here?
Just now on Delta.
What'd you think?
It's all right. I prefer KLM or Air France going here, but...
Why do you like flying?
You don't like flying. You like arriving and departing, right?
No, I actually like the act of flying because like you're completely disconnected. You can just read a book and like I love that tranquility.
Oh, that is cool. My thing with flying is like the one I'm a control freak, and it's like the one time in my life where like when I take off, I'm just like, well, the dude I've never met who's in the cockpit is completely in control of my life, and I might die because of his actions. And I'm at peace with that. It's the one time in my life where I'm at peace.
I'm the same exact way, and it blows my mind. Like, my wife and my sister-in-law have, like, flight anxiety. I'm like, this is, like, the one thing where you just submit yourself. Right. I'm coming on here.
If I die, I can die.
It's not in my hands. I bought the ticket. You're most likely not going to die unless you're in, like, a Boeing MAX 70. But you just got to submit yourself. And, like, the people that get freaked out on flights, it's like, hey, don't freak out. Drink a little bit. Yeah, it's the last moments of your life. You should be enjoying them. You shouldn't be anxious.
But the internet element is interesting too. It's because it's the one time in life nowadays where if you don't respond, it's completely acceptable. Well, I am traveling.
The being in a cross-country flight is the reason that I've only ever missed one bent in the last 2 years. Yeah. I could not get my 2FA on my internet Wi-Fi, so I could not rate the bent. I was pissed off at that, but it was therapeutic as well.
No, the funniest part about this story is that I went to give him shit because, you know, two-factor authentication through email or text is worse for you than if you use, like, actual OTP two-factor through an app. And he was like, I actually did use OTP two-factor through an app, but it needed an update, and I couldn't get the update on the airline.
Couldn't get the update on the Wi-Fi. Yeah.
So I was like, okay, like, I'll give you that, I guess.
Yeah. That's the one instance where I was like, all right, maybe I should buy a YubiKey.
Or just like use an app that doesn't require you to update to get the code.
That's true.
Like, that's ridiculous.
Yeah. So what's Portugal like?
It's really nice. Like, I would invite all Bitcoiners to just, like, we have a co-working space. It's called The Block. And it's just super nice there. Like, everyone is doing something with crypto. Everyone is doing their own project. But we have lunch together. We talk Bitcoin. Just come over for a month. Check out Lisbon. Yeah.
What's the food scene like over there?
It's really nice. And, you know, it's dirt cheap in Lisbon, like compared to any other European city.
Yeah.
I mean, you're talking to New Yorkers, so like literally everywhere but Iceland is cheap.
here. Yeah. It's like here, Zurich, San Francisco, Tokyo.
Yeah. They're all cheap. Yeah. Except for Iceland. Iceland's the only place. I went to Iceland once. Super expensive. From New York point of view, it's the only place I've ever been. As I went to fucking Hong Kong, went to 118th floor because Murad recommended the bar, and it was a fucking Ritz-Carlton. And I walk into the Ritz-Carlton bar at the 118th floor, like one of the highest bar in the world, except for fucking a dry country. Like Dubai has a higher building, which is like bullshit. Like that's not a bar if it's a fucking dry country. And I looked at the prices and I was like, this is cheap because of New York. Because New York is like ridiculous. New York is absolutely ridiculous in prices.
Yeah, it's pretty.
So Lisbon.
It's pretty fucked up here.
Yeah.
Like, Lisbon's probably. When I moved to New York from Chicago, like what I was paying in rent in Chicago, I was paying like $600 a month for one bedroom of a three bedroom, like 1,500 foot monstrosity. Moving in and paying double for a 250 square foot studio. I shared with my wife. That was a huge, like, kick in the dick.
That's rough.
Bitcoin. Lisbon. I would love to move to Lisbon.
Try it out for a month. That's what I did.
Can we do that as Americans? Can we just go there for a month?
Yeah, you can come up to 3 months.
Oh, there you go.
That's actually...
I love the idea of, like...
We have super fast internet, too. That's, like, the only thing that matters to people
that's
like
what
us.
I'm saying. Isn't
like,
that great?
Fiber.
I agree the digital nomad name is a horrible fucking name. But that lifestyle is a fantastic fucking lifestyle. Like,
what's
that
it?
Is like the lifestyle.
Let's jump into the lifestyle. Like, well, how did you decide to move to Portugal? Are you like in a month-to-month rent situation? Locked down a lease?
Well, no, I am renting a room. Like, for there's no end to it. But so I came to building on Bitcoin last summer, and then part of the event was also hosted at the block, the co-working space. And I was like, that's a much better environment than being back at home in Holland and doing it there out of my bedroom. Because here I get to meet some other Bitcoiners and it's a nicer city. So yeah, that's how I moved to Lisbon.
Yeah. You're speaking to somebody. This is my corner. You freaks can't see it. I'm in my corner where I write the bent and record the podcast. I'm pretty much in this corner for like 80% of the week.
The corner?
The corner.
What about the language difference? Because like you obviously Dutch is your first language, right?
I speak English too, but...
obviously, clearly you...
You really don't need Portuguese.
I thought we were speaking Dutch the whole time.
Have we been speaking Dutch the whole time?
Yeah, so you don't need Portuguese in Lisbon. Outside of Lisbon, you would.
But you have no Portuguese. Have you been working on it?
No.
You give us a buy Bitcoin in Portuguese? Have you learned that one?
That's the only Portuguese I know.
Stacking sats, like wherever place
you go. It's
pretty
universal.
I usually, whenever I go somewhere, I know please, thank you, where's the bathroom, can I get a beer? But like stacking sats should be, like you should know. If you're a true Bitcoiner and you like go to another country, like you should know how to say stacking sats in their language.
Well, sats would be universal, right? So you just have to figure out how to say sats.
Right, because it's stacking. Satoshi. Yeah. So stacking. You have to know how to say stacking. As long as you know how to say stack. Do you know how to say stacking in Portuguese?
I think it would be poupe Bitcoin.
Poupe sats. Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Poupe sats.
Yeah.
Wow, that just doesn't have the ring to it.
No, stacking sets is amazing. It just sounds so nice.
It sounds so good. We just...
But in an effort to spread the message to the world, if you freaks out there want to...
poop sats.
want to tweet at us what stacking sats would be in your native language, feel free.
Ooh, that's cool. Yeah, nice. I like that one.
Yeah, I like that too. Well, thank you for building Bittr to help people stack sats out there.
Thanks for hosting me today.
Well, thanks for coming. I don't know if this is a whirlwind from you, like off the airplane, through customs, on the subway to my apartment, to our studio. honored that you would take some time out of your schedule to come speak with us, man.
Thanks for inviting me.
Have you ever been to New York before?
I have been when I was living in Boston.
Right, of course.
So before we end it here, like, do you have a parting note for the freaks? So what you're building up Bittr, sort of the mission, any advice for newbies getting in, anybody learning how to build a business on Bitcoin, any sort of tidbits that you learned from your master's program, anything you want to end it on?
Well, for all your listeners, just stack sats. And if there are some other founders that want to talk to me, like on starting a company or getting some advice, just feel free to DM me on Twitter.
And where can we do that?
It's at Watermaniac.
At Water Maniac. I like that. I love that. And then what's the Bittr's handle?
Get Bittr.
At Get Bittr. Yep. Yes. And then it's at getbittr.com. That's Bittr, Bittr. We're big on cutting out and switching letters in the Bitcoin space.
One of the things is, so you reached out to us on Twitter, and then in the following RHR, I basically reached out to all of our listeners and I said to them, let us know if, because let's be frank, like in this space, there's so many fucking scams and like horrible people that operate in this space. So like I would never, and Marty as well, we would never blindly shill a company that we had no experience with. And because you're European only, we can't actually experience your business. We can't try out your business ourselves.
We should do a test transaction just here. After the podcast.
Yeah, that would be awesome. But the key thing I was going to say is that, so we reached out to our listeners and we said, a lot of you are in Europe. Can you test this out for us, or have you used it before? And we had some very quality people that we respect a shit ton. They said that they had the great experience with your product. I'm very excited to show your product going forward. Is basically what I'm saying is that I feel like this is the best way to stack sats in Europe.
I would agree, and I'm excited to see other wily entrepreneurs take after you and build a business model similar to yours, because I think it makes the most sense and reduces risk for everybody involved.
Yep.
So thank you again for building this, for spreading the good word of Bitcoin. and for joining us today in the studio.
Thank you.
You got anything to add on?
Stay humble, stack sats.
Peace and love, freaks.